Hi, and welcome to the June edition of Council Connection with me, Mike Allen, City Councilman from the 2nd District. Today we wanted to do something a little different. Last year we had our Parks Director Leroy in and we were in studio, but we decided to do a little bit more of a road show this year. Leroy, welcome to the June Council Connection.
Thanks, Councilman Allen. Hey, it's great to be out in the park today.
It is. We have so many great activities here in Spokane and beautiful parks, and today we're going to explore all you can do through the park and rec system. Not all of it. We can't get it all in an hour.
That's right.
But what we are going to do is we're going to take a look at some of the activities people can engage with, share information on what they're going to be able to, how they're going to be able to access the park system. So it should be a pretty exciting show.
All right. I'm looking forward to it.
Me too.
Well, let's get started. We're going to talk a little bit about Riverfront Park and all the great activities that are going on this summer. And with that, Debbie Dotson, Assistant Division Manager for Riverfront Parks, and give us some summer highlights.
Hi, I'm here to invite everybody down to Riverfront Park as we got a lot of great things coming up this summer. So be sure to go to our website at SpokaneRiverfrontPark.com for the latest updates. We're actually in full swing already, but when school gets out, we have everything from Bob Fest, Hoop Fest, 4th of July celebration, Royal Fireworks, and many, many more events. So check out the page and be sure to come down. Some other great things that are happening that are new this year, we have a movie series beginning July 17th. So you can come down to the Lilac Bowl and for $5 a person, we have food trucks where you can purchase your dinner. We also have live entertainment and a whole lot of great stuff going on. So it's a great family event. Bring down the pets, bring down the family, get a picnic and have a great time. So that should be something new here at the park and I think a lot of people will be able to enjoy that. Also, beginning June 15th, we have a dollar fun night at the rides area. So for a dollar per ride, you can go on any of the rides from 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. So very affordable and great family fun. Of course, some of our other great things down here at the park, we have pony rides. So you can bring your kids down to enjoy their first pony ride. You'll see lots of smiles and things like that in that particular area. We also have, of course, day passes, which gets you unlimited rides. You can go on the carousel, the tour train, and mini golf, and of course the IMAX theater. So plenty of things going on here at Riverfront Park, and we definitely want to invite you to come down and enjoy your summer.
That's great information. Hey, one of the things we have here at the park that people haven't accessed, maybe haven't got to, is the IMAX theater. The IMAX theater, it's 3 stories tall, and it really is an amazing experience. If you haven't had a chance to come down to the park recently and see it, you should. It's really worth the time and effort. So let's learn a little bit more about what's happened with the IMAX movies this summer.
If you miss the train I'm on, you will know that I am gone. You can hear the whistle blow.
From the depths of the ocean and the depths of prehistory comes the predator we love to fear. But is it the monster we've imagined it to be? We'll be right back.
Most people fear them, most people think they're the devil. For me, they're the most incredible, beautiful animals on the planet.
The interesting thing that people don't think about is that we are far more dangerous to them than they've ever been to us.
Miles of wild terrain, unpredictable dangers, unimaginable hardship, incredible humanity. Join Jeff Bridges and National Geographic as they retrace the steps of one of the greatest expeditions of all time. Lewis and Clark, Great Journey West, now on the giant screen.
As you can see, there's lots of exciting stuff happening at Riverfront Park this year between the new Fountain Cafe, the activities in the pavilion, the carousel. Make sure you check it out. But there's also more to do. This year, you know, we have great swimming pools in our city.
We absolutely do, Councilman Allen, and we have six aquatic centers that were paid for with the 2008 park bond. The citizens did a great job of supporting us and building these new six aquatic centers, and we got a great program to show you on what you could do in our aquatic centers this summer.
Summer is nearly upon us, and that means it's time for... This year's swim season is amping up to be a real splash. With slides, play structures, and lap swimming, there promises to be fun for everyone. There are six aquatic centers throughout Spokane, and each one is unique to its neighborhood.
So watch and observe, because that might happen for you when you're the rescuer.
Safety is the number one priority at all of Spokane's aquatic centers. With a rigorous training schedule for every lifeguard on duty, you can rest assured that while using one of our pools, your safety is in good hands.
Like I said, 2 weeks of training beforehand, everyone's American Red Cross certified coming into our season, and then we do, every 2 weeks we do in-services.
While the lifeguards might be ready to react to any accident, prevention is the best way to ensure a fun-filled day at the pool goes without incident.
Everyone should always swim with a buddy. Even though we do lifeguard our facilities, accidents happen in the facilities that we can't control. There's a lot of physical factors of water that make it hard to see people, so that's why having your family in there with you will keep you safer. And it's just good family time, it's good recreation, and it's good development for families and children.
If you spend most of your time on the shallow end of the pool, the City of Spokane's aquatics instructors will have you swimming laps in no time.
So if you don't know how to swim, there's many different things we can do for you. We've got Learn to Swim programs from 6 months old all the way through adults. We've got group lessons that generally go for the preteens and below, groups of 5 to 1, so it's a great ratio, great learning environment. All of our instructors are WSIs. If you're older, maybe a teen or an adult, we do adult and teen lessons. We also do private lessons. We can schedule that. The private lessons are at a premium, but we can. Those are the most flexible and one-on-one instruction with you or maybe even another person if you want.
With such phenomenal facilities, it's no surprise that our pools can become a bit crowded at times. However, if you don't like crowds or if you have a special event you'd like to celebrate, the aquatic center of your choice is available for rent.
This is a spot to be at, and you get the entire pool to yourself. It's a steal. A couple of our pools have birthday party rooms. You come in with your cake, your refreshments, set up, and have a great birthday party.
The City of Spokane's Parks and Recreation Department strives to keep swimming at its aquatic centers affordable to everyone. The current rate for swim fees are: kids up to 4 are free. Youth passes for ages 4 to 17 are $2 a session. Adult passes are $4 a session. Season passes are also available and allow unlimited pool time. Youth passes are just $60, and adult passes are $120.
You know, we've got concessions at the pools, we've got refreshments, and a lot of great water. You know, fun features, slides, play features, water spraying here and there. It's a lot of fun.
In the event of financial hardship, free youth swim passes are available. By a parent or guardian meeting certain financial criteria, a child can enjoy a summer of fun at no charge. If your child might be in need of a free pass, you will need to get your application in early, as funding for free passes is limited, and passes are given out on a first-come, first-served basis.
We have a pretty easy process for people to get those. It's a certain percentage of the poverty level, and there's lots of different indicators. Free lunch is one, and different documents people can come in to easily prove that, yeah, I'm in need of a swim pass.
If you'd like to make a financial donation for a swim fee scholarship, log on to SpokaneParksFoundation.org for more information. Prior to heading to the pool, you'll need to make sure that you have the proper swimwear to be admitted.
And it's an effort to make sure that kids have a swimsuit to go swimming in. It's connected with the health department and making sure that, you know, we're trying to cut down on recreational water illnesses and just make sure people have an appropriate suit to go swimming.
The Parks Foundation is also accepting new bathing suits and financial donations to ensure that children have the proper attire to visit our aquatic facilities. This swimming season is just getting underway, and if you'd like more information about our local aquatic centers or their programs, log on to SpokaneParks.org.
Our pools are great, but if you're like me, you prefer to golf. And we have some amazing golf courses. If you've been out there this year, the greens are in great shape. We have four amazing courses. Tell us a little bit more about golf here in Spokane.
Well, Councilman Allen, we really do. We have four courses that are unique. We have the Creek of Qualchen, which is our newest course. It's going to give you a little bit more of an open golfing experience. Got some challenges going over Latah Creek. There's no doubt about it. We have our most historic course, and that's Indian Canyon. You get to play in the trees. It's quite beautiful and has a lot of challenges. And then, of course, Downriver, which we got really great accolades last year from the Inlander on our Downriver golf course, voted best golf course in the area. And then Esmeralda, which they used to call it Easy Ezzy, but with all the trees that are growing in now, not so easy today. We got a great following, a great men's club there. And so, we really encourage citizens to get out and golf our courses this summer.
Well, we have a great piece. We're going to show everyone a little bit about the history of our courses. And so I hope you enjoy it.
For over 100 years, golf has played a part in the growth of Spokane and in the lives of its citizens. Golf in Spokane got its start in 1897 when a temporary course was set up in the large yard of Mr. and Mrs. F. Lewis Clark's home on West 7th Avenue. The site would later be used as Marycliffe High School. The first official course in Spokane was a Spokane Country Club, which first organized in 1898. The original location was in the Liberty Park area and included 9 holes and sand greens. The original clubhouse still stands on 14th Street. In 1904, the Country Club moved to a new location near what is now known as Hart Field. It also had 9 holes, but featured real grass greens. In 1908, the clubhouse at this location burned to the ground. A search began for a new location, and in 1911, the Spokane Country Club opened at its present-day Northside site on the Little Spokane River. With the interest in golf increasing, the first city public course opened in 1914 on land now occupied by Phelps Field. It was called Upriver Golf Course and had 9 holes for beginners and another 9 for experienced players. In order to raise money for a new city course in 1915, the city offered golfers a 2-year season pass for $15. Money raised got construction started on the Riverside Golf Course on Spokane's north side. The course opened May 1, 1916 as a 9-hole course.
In 1916, when Downriver Golf Course, as it is known now, opened up, it was then Riverside Golf Club, and hole number 1 is our current hole number 11.
A round of golf at Riverside cost 25 cents during the week and 50 cents on the weekends. Caddies were paid 20 cents an hour. With the popularity of the Riverside course, the City Park Board decided to close the Upriver Golf Course. With the additions of the Manitou Country Club in 1917 and Wandermere in 1929, interest in golf was growing at a rapid pace. Play at the Riverside course had gotten to the point that another course was needed to satisfy the demand of local golfers. The city had acquired some land west of town on Sunset Hill, and work was begun on Indian Canyon Golf Course. Much of the land clearing was done by hand and with teams of horses. The clubhouse at Indian Canyon was built of natural rocks from the area. The course opened for play in August of 1935. A grand opening celebration brought out several hundred people, including dignitaries and Native Americans.
Indian Canyon, to me, is the gem of Spokane golf. It's It was built as part of a couple different government projects. Started in 1933 and actually completed and opened in August of 1935. And then the grand opening was April of 1936. And it's always been included in the best public golf course in the United States. Just a great golf course, great design, famous designer, H. Chandler Egan. I love it here, and I think Spokane's lucky to have it.
During the 30s and 40s, men's golf became very competitive in the area, and many tournaments took place at Spokane courses. In 1941, Indian Canyon hosted the National Public Links Championship. A golfer by the name of Bill Welch came to Spokane from Texas and won the championship of the week-long competition. Welch fell in love with the Indian Canyon course and said he had never seen a course that beautiful in his whole life. The next year he would move to Spokane and would eventually serve as the head professional at the Canyon from 1965 until 1984. In 1946, the Park Board asked the Spokane Athletic Roundtable organization to help fund a new city course. The art group acquired some land on the northeast part of town and deeded it to the city under two conditions. It must be used as a golf course, and it must be called Esmeralda. Esmeralda was the racehorse that the group had sponsored in the 1930s to finance various community projects.
And they, in collaboration with the city, did a perfect kind of private-public partnership to come up with the golf course. And the primary stipulation from the Athletic Roundtable is that it would be named Esmeralda, which is the mascot of the Athletic Roundtable. And over the years, the Athletic Roundtable has kind of helped us sponsoring various events, junior tournaments, and things like that. And it was really a nice relationship, and they were fabulous and really instrumental into the development of Esmeralda Golf Course.
Esmeralda opened with a bang on April Fool's Day in 1956, as art members used some fireworks to simulate an eruption of an extinct volcano, which sits just east of the 18th green. Esmeralda was designed to offer golfers a pleasant experience. It was a fairly open course with no water hazards. Over the years, the course has become the most heavily played in the area. Around 1958, the name of the Riverside Golf Course was changed to Downriver. A new clubhouse and range were added to the course.
In 1960, the existing clubhouse was constructed, replacing a river rock clubhouse similar to Indian Canyon's that sat above number 18 green.
Spokane's newest city course, the Creek at Qualchan, opened for play in 1993. The course is on 225 acres of land next to Highway 195, with Latah Creek running through the course.
Well, some of the nice features about the Creek at Qualchan are our many hazards we have out on the course. We have over 50 sand traps throughout the 18 holes. Combine that with 12 of our holes have water in play, either in front of you or on the side of you, so it makes the Creek at Qualchan a unique challenge for the Spokane area golfers. We opened in 1993, so this is our 14th season. Each year we're doing more and more rounds. People are getting accustomed to playing the different challenges out here at Qualchan.
With a mild winter and hard work by the greenskeepers, conditions on the four city courses are outstanding this year.
And the city has a wonderful system for taking care of the golf courses. I feel very fortunate in that I think my crew is an outstanding, hardworking crew. Don Nelson, the head superintendent, does a magnificent job. He's out there every day of the week. I just love him. I can't imagine a better superintendent.
Golf course conditions are phenomenal. We've got a wonderful maintenance crew, and things couldn't be better here at Downriver as far as playing conditions go.
Well, I've talked to a number of people over the years that were involved in the construction of Esmeralda, and this year we are celebrating our 50th year, so a lot of people are taking advantage of that to share their stories. And I talked to some youngsters, well, they're youngsters at the time, who are older gentlemen now, who hand-watered all the trees that they were planted, and we have just a fabulous variety of deciduous trees out here. I've never actually heard the inventory. Someone tells me 2,000, but I've had days when I've been playing where I feel like there might be a few more.
Over the years, the courses have hosted a number of PGA events and celebrity tournaments.
We actually host literally over 100 company events and charitable events. Since we get an awful lot of people from out of the Spokane area that come into town specifically to play the golf course, and there's an awful lot of conventions, I would say probably the majority of the conventions that have tournaments associated with them end up playing them up here. And then we also, every year, we probably have 20 or 30 of the same charitable events up here. So it's a very busy tournament course. It's a very busy course with people from out of the area.
The professionals at all of the city courses are strong supporters of junior golfers in Spokane and encourage introducing the game to kids at an early age.
We're doing the junior lessons out here, and this is a great place for kids to learn how to play golf. We've actually, in 2004, began the process of cutting in a set of junior tees on all 18 holes. So when parents come out to play with their young kids, the holes might be a little bit too long for them. So we have some holes ranging from 200 yards to as short as 150 yards. And it gives the kids a course that they can play. We develop their own scorecard for the junior course, and it makes it kind of nice. And we use them in conjunction with our city junior lessons that we teach each summer. And at the end of our lessons, we'll take them out to play, and it's a lot of fun.
Junior program went very well. What we've been doing is going over basically all the areas of golf, putting, chipping, irons and woods. And today for the final lesson, we're going out on the golf course and playing from the 100-yard marker in, just to give the kids a feel of what we've been going over. Getting them out on the golf course and they having that, you know, the experience that they, you know, that they'll need further, hopefully get them in there so they'll be ready to play. It's great to get them started as early as possible so they can get the early fundamentals down, so hopefully they can take it a step further as they get old.
From the history of Downriver to the beauty of Indian Canyon, and from the open landscape of Esmeralda to the challenges of Qualchin, the four Spokane City courses offer a unique and enjoyable experience for golfers of any age and ability. If you would like to learn more about the history of golf in Spokane, look for Bill Elston's book, Golf History of Spokane, Washington, a 101-year tradition. And for more information about the city courses, as well as junior lessons and tournaments, visit the website at SpokaneGolf.org.
Welcome back from the golf piece. It was a great look at the history of golf here in Spokane, and we really do and are very blessed to have some great courses. But the other access we have through parks is our outdoor programs. A lot of people don't know that you can actually go as a group or an individual and through one of our programs and float our beautiful rivers around here, access skiing and lessons. Leroy, can you tell us a little bit more about our outdoor programs?
Well, absolutely. I mean, I think everybody knows we're in an outdoor mecca. We really try to emphasize that through our outdoor recreation program here in Parks and Recreation. And you're right, you can access the river, you can access the Little Spokane River, and you can get out into Riverside State Park and enjoy a lot of outdoor activities there. And the best way to find out about that information is to go to our rec guide, our summer rec guide, and the best place to access that is on our webpage at SpokaneParks.org, and you can find out all kinds of great information about our outdoor recreation programs.
Well, we have a great piece that goes and shows a little bit about what you can do with our outdoor rec programs.
The outdoor program runs over 100 trips a year, and we take the citizens of Spokane out to national forests, into the state parks, into natural areas, on all sorts of waterways and lands, and just show Spokane what really makes this place a wonderful place to live.
One thing we do is grouping it up with food and beverages of sorts, spirits. That usually goes well. We don't want it to be boring.
Our stewardship goals benefit from outdoor recreation opportunities because they provide a platform for increasing awareness and offering education.
Again, a really nice piece about how you can access and the activities you can do here through our Parks and Rec program. But if you're not so interested in going out, maybe floating, you can also have a great experience getting outdoors right here within our own urban corridor with our trail system. We have a couple of great trails that begin right in the downtown. Leroy, you want to tell us a little more about those?
Well, probably the most famous one locally here, of course, is the Centennial Trail. And we're sitting here in Riverfront Park today, and you can catch the Centennial Trail and head directly east from Riverfront Park and all the way to Coeur d'Alene. I mean, it's a pretty amazing trail system. And then this summer, we've been working on the planning of moving the trail to the west of Riverfront Park. And so the trail is going to go through Veterans Park and then on through Kennedy Yards Development and then west of Kennedy Yards Development. And we're really only going to have a small gap left as you kind of connect up into Riverside State Park. So pretty amazing system. We're getting some new changes to it this summer. We're really excited about that. And then the other really neat trail that we have that's right, the trailhead is right next to downtown, is the Fish Lake Trail. And the Fish Lake Trail can take you 8 miles west of Spokane, outside of the city limits into Spokane County, almost to Fish Lake, and we got a gap in there that we're working on as well. But what's really interesting is that this trailhead is just, you know, right off of Sunset Boulevard, and the parking lot is full almost every evening. The trail is an old railroad grade, so it's less than 2% all the way, nice flat trail, got nice shade along it, and we see a lot of families out there and a lot of people enjoying that portion of the trail.
Yeah, that's one of the things people may not realize is that these trails really, they either run along the river or they're old railroad trails, and so they have a very easy medium grade that you can, you know, access. So it's a very enjoyable experience as well.
And you can really choose what you want. If you want to be on the Centennial Trail, you're going to get a little more of an urban experience. You can hop off the trail and, you know, find restaurants and places like that as you kind of move east. And if you want more of that kind of natural experience in the outdoor, then you're going to want to take the Centennial Trail to the west, the Riverside State Park, or the Fish Lake Trail.
It's a great experience. Speaking of natural environment, Spokane has a great Frisbee Park right on the river, right below Downriver Golf Course. Can you share a little more about that?
Yeah, and we actually have three of them. Two of them that have been around for a little while. One we have in Highbridge Park, and it's a great relationship with the you know, we have a nonprofit Frisbee Association that we work with, and they maintain the courses. They're free. So we have one in Highbridge Park, and then we have one down just to the west of Downriver Golf Course on the river. So, you know, one of them is right by Laetah Creek. The other is overlooking the Spokane River. You know, beautiful location, Riverside State Park right across the water. And then this spring, we also have built a new course, and again, working with the Disc Golf Association out at Camp Sakani. That's our newest course. And when I talk to the disc golfers, that's the one they're most excited about right now. So, you know, it's just like golfing. You get to see something new, and you get to experience a new environment. And that one's interesting because it's really interwoven with a lot of bicycle trails and walking trails out there. So, you know, great multi-use area. And that's just east of downtown on Upriver Drive. It's actually a city park in the county. But we encourage people to get out there. It's a great new course.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. You know, some of the other things are more traditional parks from the Olmsted brothers. We have, you know, Manitou Park with its many facets, from mm-hmm. Duncan Gardens to the Rose Garden to the pond to the park bench. We have a little restaurant up there.
Yeah, absolutely. We have some music on Friday nights at the park bench, which is really exciting. But our gardens are definitely something that's been around in our system for a while. It's definitely a highlight for a lot of people in the summer. The one that is our newest addition is the Moore Turner Heritage Gardens. It's in the Edwards Wolson Park, just off of 7th on Lower South Hill. Beautiful location. Late spring, early summer is a great time to visit those gardens. Very quiet there. You know, it's a place if you wanted a little bit of a break away from the intensity of your day, that's a good place to go. And then we have our traditional rose garden at Manitou. You have a perennial garden, which the Ferris perennial gardens are just beautiful, and they're really coming out here in late spring, early summer as well. And Duncan Garden just planted in the last couple weeks, and you'll see those flowers coming out. And then, of course, the Japanese garden, which I think is a big favorite of people. That parking lot is full quite often. So, and we're really fortunate in Spokane to have some really nice gardens.
The other thing we have in a lot of our parks over the summer is a lot of the neighborhood associations or groups host concerts in the park. And so I'd encourage you to get on to the Neighborhood Services website, and it'll tell you a little bit more about maybe there's a concert at one of the parks in your neighborhood as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And we have a great relationship with neighborhoods. Love to see them out using the parks. And I think music and parks make a lot of sense.
They do. Very enjoyable together. Well, as you've seen through our show today, there are so many activities to do out here in Spokane through our Parks and Rec system. Again, Leroy, if they want to access, what's the website?
Yeah, SpokaneParks.org, and it's a great website. You can find everything you need to know about parks and recreation.
So whether it's enjoying the carousel or bringing your kids down to the rides or having a serene moment at one of our parks or canoeing or eating at the New Fountain Cafe, get out and enjoy your parks. I hope you have a great summer.